Hiya, I'm Mike Sweeney, and when my band The Salford Jets had a hit with that song, Gina, I've Got a Cortina, the car was fast becoming a collector's item. It was a great car to pull the birds in, and to a certain extent, if you've got one, it still is. Now, for 20 years, the Cortina was the UK's biggest selling Ford product, and it was mega overseas as well. There were factories in Australia and South Africa, and of course, there was the legendary Dagenham plant. Now, if you personally never drove a Cortina, I can guarantee that your mum or your dad, your auntie or your uncle, or your gran or your granddad definitely did. And I'll tell you something, they'd have loved it to bits. So relax and chill out, because the next hour here on Men & Motors, we're going to spend that time in the company of Ford's most awesome automobile. Cos, Gina, I've got a Cortina.
They're easy, they're reliable cars, they're easy to work on.
It's a very sexy shape of a car.
I've had the car now for 12 months. It's never let me down, starts first time.
The 1600 Aces are in Cortina.
Just drive them and enjoy them.
Individual, just like myself.
It's touched basically every motorist's life, and it's still doing so today.
All right, gotta go. Got a Cortina to buy.
This is America in the 1950s, and it seems that everybody's driving around in these ginormous spaceships on wheels. I'll tell you something, on these babies, you'd probably go through more gallons of chrome cleaner than you would fuel. But the styling of these stateside beasts is so futuristic and, above all, mega exciting. Meanwhile, over here in the little old United Kingdom, we were still trundling around to the post office in these little boxes on wheels.
In the 1950s, you tended to buy things like Hillman Minxes and Maurice Oxfords, and Vauxhall Victors, I guess, which were quite heavy, stodgy, very ordinary family saloons.
OK, maybe our cramped island's not the most suitable venue to zoom around in personal transportation the size of battleships, but the glamour of the all-American dream was so attractive to British motorists. Ford were the first to recognise this, so when they launched the Zephyr, the Zodiac and the Consul in the UK, they were instant hits.
This is a closer look at the superbly styled new Zodiac. Long, low, elegant. The new Zephyr, the new Consul convertible.
Now here was affordable motoring for the punters. But we're not just talking about utility runarounds here. Ford had on sale cars with the added pizzazz, styling and performance that gave you the feeling you were a Hollywood superstar.
After the introductions had been formally made, the guests were invited to inspect the exhibits. They didn't have to be asked twice.
Ford's small car offering from 1959 was the Anglia, whose rear sloping window has been brought back into fashion again on the new Renault Clio. But today's kids, here in this age of Harry Potter, when they think of the Anglia, it's a useful vehicle when you've missed the last train to Hogwarts. The Ford Anglia's main rival was this. This is BMC's amazing new Mini. It was getting tons of press attention, and it seemed to offer similar space inside as the Anglia, but with one big difference. The Mini was miles cheaper to buy, and this frightened Ford to death.
When the Mini arrived, Ford realised the problem was going to be, was the public going to be totally sold on technical novelty, or was it going to be sold on value? And this was the big fight in the 1960s.
Here was a brand new type of car. It was small on the outside, big inside, with a transverse mounted front wheel drive setup, so it was entirely different.
Designer Alec Isagonis had this idea to come up with a car that made the most effective use of space, in which four people could fit with relative comfort. So to save a few more valuable inches, he put the gearbox under the engine rather than behind it. The public loved the Mini because, of course, it was dead affordable, and it became a huge success. Now, Ford desperately needed to know the Mini's secrets. How could such a great product be sold for such a low price?
There was a great problem to get our hands on a Mini, but finally we did, and you can learn an awful lot about the costing of a motor car if you weigh each of the components.
So one of the gang at Ford trotted out to a BMC garage, got a Mini on the office petty cash, I wouldn't mind office petty cash like that, and took it back to Ford's HQ. There, they simply stripped it down and costed out the parts and labour required to put the car together.
BMC, or as it was at that stage, was losing £5 on every Mini that it sold. under the prices that they'd fixed for themselves, they couldn't possibly make a profit. And that didn't even include the warranty costs.
Terry Beckett then became convinced that if Ford were going to compete at all with the Mini, it had to be with a bigger, simpler car at the right price.
So Ford decided to keep its own prices realistic and wait for BMC to go pear-shaped. And of course, they did. If you remember, BMC had to merge with Leyland to create the magnificent, not British Leyland. But that's another story. Ford had always prided itself that it kept in touch with Punterville and what Punterville wanted. And they realised that overall, people needed more space for the kids and luggage. And let's be honest, the Anglia and the Little Mini were never designed to be family cars. Something larger was needed. Plus, of course, there was the ongoing punch-up with Ford of Germany. And the situation was this, that Ford of Germany were plotting to bring out a new family car. Ford UK wanted to do this before them, so they had to act and act like the clappers.
Way back in the 1920s, Henry Ford in Detroit had started setting up European subsidiaries. He set up a company in Germany, he set up a company in France, he set up a company, obviously, in Britain. Those companies all were in healthy competition.
Ford of Germany products have been sold alongside Ford of Britain products in the same Ford dealerships right up until the 70s.
To some extent, it was a carry-on from World War II.
The chairman of Ford saw and heard that the Germans were about to produce a new motor car called the Taunus. That was front-wheel drive, very similar size to this car. And his immediate reaction was, we must make a rival for the Taunus. Not we must make a rival for the Maurice Oxford, we must make a rival for the Taunus, because they were selling against the Taunus all over Europe.
But Ford didn't just build any old car to pig their rivals off. It had to be a great car, a car that would sell, a car that people wanted. So they needed to talk to the public and find out what they needed from this new car. So, at pains to explain this, Ford made this weird and bizarre cinema short film which used humour, well, the humour of the 60s, which is about as funny today as diesel in your petrol tank. The film showed a besuited Brill Cream Ford type travelling about Europe, asking some painfully obvious stereotypes what they wanted from a motor car. Very un-PC. Now, apart from the fact that this was being obviously filmed in the UK, for example, the German beer garden was probably in someone's yard in Accrington, and this south of France beach is probably filmed in a kid's sandpit, but it does demonstrate that data was being collected from a wide range of motorists so that Ford could design their next big seller.
Ford of Britain had its product planning department for the first time. By putting the engineers together with the product planners and really looking at the market seriously for the first time, we realised that there was a gap between the Mini 105e Anglia and the next car in the Ford range, which was the Consul, which was a much larger motor car. And the Cortina dropped very neatly into that gap.
But what to do with all this data that Ford had collated? The big corporations did have computers in those days, but they didn't sit on desktops. They took up the space of a small town. They were massive. And the data was on huge spools of magnetic tape, not on hard disks. It was just like the one on the Italian job. But the machine did its job, and after a few years waiting, well actually a few weeks waiting, the calculations came out, the machine spat out the answers, and the designers had all they needed to know about this new car. They apparently wanted, the general public that is, the new Cortina.
Ford spent a lot of time looking at the marketplace, and they decided that the one thing they needed to offer was not technical novelty, they needed to offer space, they needed to offer economy, and typical of Henry Ford, they needed to offer cars very cheaply. So the Cortina, if you like, was more space, more of most things, but at a very low cost.
It really was a large car. There's room for five, probably even six at a push inside. And the boot, plenty of room too.
Because the Cortina had a huge boot, absolutely huge boot.
Plenty of room for all the things that you couldn't even hope to get in a Mini.
Compared to, say, the Anglia, the passengers had loads more legroom in the back, and the boot was cavernous, even enough for this stereotypical Frenchman to put his onions in. Oh yes, it's very nice, this nouveau Cortina. It is énorme, très mega. And so our French friend takes his family down to the beach. What a happy family. And everybody helps to erect the windbreaks and a big nice tent to protect everybody from the blazing sun. Oh, but who's this gatecrashing the party? Oh, it's the Cortina, of course. We can't have the Riviera sun spoiling the paintwork, can we? The Cortina was loved like one of the family.
The expectations were growing in the 60s. People were beginning to take regular holidays. And they were, in fact, going on their holidays in their motor cars. And they were beginning to travel into Europe.
What they were saying is, here's a large family car for a small price.
So the Cortina was born. But why the name? Right, the car was originally going to be called the new Consul 225. And they even took some press pictures with the 225 badges on.
When the choice of name had to be made, it was the younger element at Ford, particularly led by that legend of Ford Motor Company, Walter Hayes, who cast around for a more glamorous name.
Initially, it wasn't even going to be called the Cortina, and it wasn't until probably a month before we did the launch that we changed the name to Cortina, because we wanted to make it more European and appeal to more European buyers.
Cortina, being a ski resort in the Dolomites, had just been used for a Winter Olympics. It was a name that was still in the public eye, and apparently Ford marketing people said, good, we'll use Cortina, people will remember it.
This is the performance story of Ford of Britain's newest entry in the small car market. Watch it in action here at the Ford Proving Circuit and on the British Army's Fighting Vehicles Test Ground. Not spectacular driving arranged specially for the cameras, but routine work to ensure that the car's achievements are as remarkable as its specification. Watch the performance of a small car with a big difference.
Strangely, the official name for the car was the Consul Cortina. I remember that. As Ford were desperate to hold on to the good name of the Consul. But, like the Renault drivers of today who call their MPV a Scenic and not a Megane Scenic, the Consul name was generally forgotten.
Even a few months before the Cortina was announced, it was going to be called a Consul. And the very first publicity pictures of the car show it with badges at the front end of the motor car, badged Consul only. Cortina came much later. Incidentally, the word Cortina means curtains in Spanish.
Now, loads of motoring journalists at the time gave the new Cortina a right battering. For instance, the Mini had front-wheel drive and a revolutionary rubber suspension. Plus, in the States, those new air-cooled engines were taking off and creating talking points. The Ford Cortina looked like it was essentially old technology. The engine, the gearbox, and the axle came from the old Anglia.
Leaf springs at the rear, McPherson strut front. Very simple, easy to maintain, didn't require too much maintenance, and a lot of the maintenance you could actually do yourself as an owner.
Let's just say this, the critics were dead wrong. There was no way that Ford were trying to take the punters to the cleaners. They were simply trying to minimise problems with the new car by avoiding new technology. And of course, they wanted to keep the price dead right. And in this, they were absolutely spot on.
There was no point in producing a mass market car if people couldn't afford to run it.
It is the Model T for the 60s.
The public loved the new Cortina when it was launched back in 62. Here it was a new kind of car. It had pin-sharp styling, it was fashionable, exciting, large, and yet frugal.
And in a very short space of time, Ford was making 1,000 cars a day, which was unheard of in the British motor industry.
Join us in part two as we continue the story of the Ford Cortina. Hi, I'm Mike Sweeney, and welcome once more to this fabulous story of a fabulous car, the Ford Cortina. Why was it such a success? Absolutely brilliant styling. American Roy Brown was brought in as part of the styling team. Now, in the States at that time, they had these big Buck Rogers fins on the back of cars. I was never going to work in the UK, so for the Cortina, they were scaled down. And what about those Y-cluster lights on the back of the Mark 1? Was it part of the Ban the Bomb campaign of the 60s? Or was it a Merc badge on upside down? Or was it simply a logical way of getting three lights working properly, visible on the back of the car? Let's look at the styling of this classic car.
Very early on in the project, the very striking and famous Cortina flutes down the side were part of the package. But it was only at the very last minute that the equally recognisable Cortina trademark of the circular rear lamps was adopted.
What the Cortina did is the Cortina brought in some European exciting styling, Michelotti lines, beautiful.
Now, sitting behind the wheel of a Ford Cortina after driving a modern car, you wonder where all the switch gear's gone. Actually, it was never there. The standard Cortina was costed right down to the minimum.
When the Cortina was designed and developed, it was the first motor car Ford had ever produced where every item in the car was costed. There was an amount of money allocated for every feature of the car, and at one point, there's no question that the original interior spec was very simple indeed. And in fact, when the chairman, when Sir Patrick Hennessy saw the motor car for the first time, he looked at his staff and said, it's a bit bare inside. And in fact, he allocated some money just to upgrade the spec.
Each of the marks of the Cortina, the Mark 1 from 62 to 66, the Mark 2, 62 to 70, the Mark 3, 70 to 76, the Mark 4, 76 to 80, and Mark 5, 80 to 82, each of those marks sold a million.
But in comparison with some of the gas guzzlers that had gone before, the Cortina in all its guises was really economical with fuel. Now, if you're wondering what's going on in this promotional film, this gentleman has just asked for a gallon of fuel to fill up with, and then proudly puts his change in the pile of coins he's collecting in the glove box. That's another example, I'm afraid, of 60s humour.
The great Ford beat the champ competition. The champ, saloon car ace, Sir John Whitmore. The test, how far can you drive on 1 pint of petrol? The car, the new Cortina 1300 automatic. Big, big prizes will be won, and there's a national champ to be found. Sir John's travelled 5 miles, 1408 yards. Can you beat the champ?
This was a motor car that was much lighter, hundreds of pounds lighter than the competition from other companies, and also it had modern engines which were very economical to run.
Now, throughout the design of the Ford Cortina, the mantra was save weight, and a 1.2 litre engine from the Heavy Anglia 105E didn't exactly offer good performance or economy. So, by carefully minimising unnecessary parts and by hiring aircraft engineers who knew all about weight savings, over 300 pounds in weight was shaved off the new nimble Cortina. This saved cash at the pumps, and of course, that extra performance put smiles on the faces of those Cortina drivers.
Previous Fords, like the Anglia, like the Classic, had been solidly engineered, comfortably engineered, but they were certainly not as light as they might have been. Ford decided to make a change. To make this car more economical, they hired in a man from the Bristol Aeroplane Company called Dennis Roberts, who was an aircraft stress engineer and an expert on structures. No computers in those days, of course, so Dennis Roberts apparently sat down in a corner with a drawing board, hundreds and hundreds of sheets of paper, and as a result came up with a structure that was much lighter, hundreds of pounds lighter, than anything that Ford could have done by conventional methods.
There was no point in having a big body if it was heavy and it needed a V6 engine under the bonnet, and also given the market it was aimed at, it would have been far too expensive to run. So the science was to make it big, attractive, roomy, comfortable, and economical.
Now, nothing could go wrong with the Cortina project. To be honest, the entire company's future was at stake. This is why Ford didn't gamble with new engine technologies. The tried and trusted 1959 four-cylinder power plants with those old-fashioned pushrod overhead valve operations were simple and rugged and, above all, reliable. Cortina drivers had the choice of two transmission systems when the car was launched. Nope, I'm afraid not manual or auto. Auto boxes were a good few years in the future. The choice was between a traditional centre floor gear change or an American-style steering column change. Cables connected the gearbox and the steering column together. The advantage of this was it left the front seats clear, so in those pre-seatbelt law days, you could cram loads of people in the front. But although the overseas owners loved these innovations, we in the UK hated them to bits.
One of the basic advantages of it was that you could sit three people in the front if the car was wide enough.
We have rather more gears in our gearboxes. Five is the norm, six is here. Eventually we're going to be looking at sort of sevens and eights. And people are asking for a sportier motor car. And the fashion is that you have it down on the deck.
Over 90% of us opted for the traditional floor-mounted gear change.
In Britain, the take-up of sales in this country was very low. Ford persisted with a column change on this car for about 5 or 6 years. But in the end, they had to give in to fashion. The public, the man with the money, said, we want a centre change, and that's what they got.
The Cortina was tested and tested and tested before Punterland got their hands on it.
A small car with a big difference.
And it was a massive difference. Most family cars before the Cortina had limp performance and spent most of their motoring life trundling on the low side of 50 miles an hour. Trundle, trundle, trundle. This really had the wow factor for the keen motorist. Plus, of course, it was a practical family vehicle as well.
There was a Cortina for everyone. And if you just wanted bargain basement motoring, then you could get a Cortina.
This is Maurice from Bolton in Lancashire, who has two cherished Cortinas. One, which he uses every day to get to work.
It started with my dad in 1977 when he first got his Mark IV Cortina. And he just sort of went from there. I was very intrigued by the car, as you are, as a young lad. I just got the feeling like everybody wanted a Cortina. I've had the car now for 12 months. It's never let me down. Starts first time, performance perfect. My dad showed me how to maintain them. You know, even a seven-year-old, he was showing me how to look after them, how to maintain them. When we used to take it in for its service at a garage in Darlington, I used to always be in the showroom getting all the catalogues and everything. It was a stylish car. Everybody liked the Cortina. There was just something about the Cortina that everybody liked and everybody wanted one. The Mark V was, it had all the finishing touches to the Mark IV. You know, you had a better heating system, you had more headroom, you got more glass area in a Mark V. And the Mark V just looks a better, classier car.
Yes, for Maurice Bennett, he'll be driving Ford forever. They may even have to bury him in his beloved Cortina.
I've had three Cortinas in the past. This one here I use every day. It's parked outside, never garaged, never let me down. Good old motor.
We caught Andrew Charles and his son in their beloved 1600E. Isn't that flipping wonderful? And Andrew is unashamedly a fan of the technology of the 1960s.
Yeah, this is a 1600E. I guess it was the boy racer car of its time. I just love it. It's the wood.
Yep, Andrew, it's in the wood.
The smell of the car, it just gives you something that a new car can't. It's just individual. I would never have a new car. I much prefer the older cars, such as the Cortinas. They've just got character. They've got styling, which a new car to me doesn't have. I get more looks in a Cortina than I do in a new car. And people appreciate the older cars far more than a new car. I was a 60s/70s child, so I guess I'm just trying to not relive the past, but try and recreate a bit of it and own it myself. I guess I own a bit of the 60s and 70s.
Darren Seed is a self-confessed Cortina crackpot, and he's the proud owner of this two-door conversion. It took him 5 years to put together.
Right, my name's Darren Seed. I'm from Preston. I'm 35. I've been obsessed with Cortinas most of my life. This is my latest project. Took me 4 or 5 years to build. It's got a Rover up front, narrowed axle at the back, 4-bar link, uprated brakes, roll cage as you can see. It's purely a drag car, but it's road legal. I work with new cars, right up to date, brand new cars. Yeah, they're just pressed metal and pressed plastic. I've got to say, this is the height of what I want out of a Cortina. It's all built, hand-built by myself. Every single engineering thing's done by myself. Nothing's been bought or anything, so everything's been made. Everybody from family car, because of the room, the accessibility to get to the back seats, if you've got a family. Yeah. And then you've got the sporty side of it. Adjustable suspension, McPherson struts was like wow when it came out. You could actually put it into a corner and get out straight. A very reliable car. The bodywork on them is, you know, if you buy a Cortina, you've got a Cortina forever, providing you look after it.
Now, Darren's wife, Carol, is into Cortinas big time as well. And so, obviously, her and Darren get on like a house on fire.
All other cars are just bags of metal. Just normal, everybody's got one. Not everybody's got a Mark III Cortina, especially a bright orange one. Extremely reliable. Never let me down once. It's driven every day. It's serviced regularly. It's well looked after. My husband the other day walked in the house with two nuts and he said to me, these are off a Cortina, Carol. He said, where do they go? And I thought, God, you are so sad, because I actually knew where they went. They actually went on the back seat, holding the back of the back seat on. And I just thought, God, that is just so sad.
You've got it bad.
Bit too much.
Before we leave this wacky couple, let Darren say farewell with a bit of a burnout. On this show, we've met all sorts of Cortina lovers, including a guy who drives his car every day of the year, and not just for owners' rallies. His name's Dave Eastwood, and he's chairman of the Cortina Owners Club.
Why Cortinas? They're reliable cars, they're easy to work on, and they're totally different from the modern car of today. Easier to work on, cheaper to run. This car I'm sat in at the moment is a 1982 Mark V. It's a 2.3 V6. When I bought it in 1989, it had 53,000 miles on the clock. It now has 169,000. I'm different from the average guy in the street, I would say.
The performance is exciting, though some people can take things too seriously. But this Cortina is a car that adds a new dimension to everyday motoring. The kind of car you'll feel you've enjoyed driving, even if you've only been shopping.
And these were the days before the ISOFIX British Standard child safety seats and the compulsory seatbelt laws. You could shove as many kids as you could fit on that huge vinyl-covered bench seat and you'd be laughing.
We've got the teddy bears in, we've got the golf clubs, we've got the racing car. And if you don't happen to carry those things but you have a bigger family, you can pack those in as well. Even with five children in the back, you can drive in a more or less relaxed fashion, safe in the knowledge that they're kept in the four-door Cortina with child-proof safety locks.
Maybe today we pamper our kids too much. When I was a kid, I was lucky to get a sauce butty and a clip round the ear hole. If you're in a car with your kids now, it's, Dad, there's no Dolby on the DVD. This is a disaster.
Really, seatbelts were not around. It's as simple as that. The only people that were playing with seatbelts at that time were Volvo. And the people that, if you had a seatbelt, you were going into sort of competition with your motor car.
Do you recognise Colin Chapman here? Well, Ford's association with Lotus goes back a long way. And Colin and his experts worked on the 995 Anglia engine in the Formula Junior racing car, and it was dead successful. It was a natural progression for Lotus to be adapting the already excellent driving characteristics of the Cortina for success on the track.
And apart from the green stripe, the most obvious sign that it is a Lotus Cortina is the reduced ride height. It's 4 to 6 inches lower than the normal Cortina would have been. Doors are aluminium. Interior, you've got that wood-rimmed steering wheel, which was considered the great thing of the time, but if you put your head through it, was absolutely lethal. Aluminium bonnet, and the heart of the motor car, the Lotus twin cam engine, which actually used a Ford 1500cc cylinder block and a number of other Ford items such as the oil pump, but Weber carburetors and a twin cam cylinder head. Surprise, surprise, you can actually release the bonnet from outside the motor car without having to break into it. So if you had a mind, you could actually remove the whole engine without having to seal the motor car.
Here's some footage of Jim Clark doing his bit with the Cortina in Australia at breathtaking speeds of up to 84 miles an hour. Wow, he wins the race.
At an average speed of almost 84 miles per hour, Jim Clark in a Cortina wins outright and takes a first in class, with the other Cortinas adding 2 and 3 and 4 to the classification.
Join me, folks, in part three of this great car story, the Ford Cortina's magnificent sporting achievements. Hiya gang, welcome back. It's now the final part of you and I here with Men and Motors and the legend that is the Ford Cortina. Now, although the Ford Cortina was really a family car, Ford tried so hard to push it up the aspirational ladder. You've got to have a look at this cinema film. Talk about make you laugh. It really is very funny. Right, this ain't your normal two up, two down in Peckham. This is one grand pad. And this is, by any standards, a posh bird. You can tell this because when she kisses her husband, I assume it's not the gamekeeper, she leaves a good 6 inches between her mouth and his. We're talking very posh snogging here. In fact, should we see that again? Yep, that's a posh kiss. Now, you'd think that if this couple owned a pad like this stately home, that they could afford something better than the average family car. You would, wouldn't you? But the point of this posh bird getting herself comfy in those wonderful reclining seats is that the Cortina was now being marketed as a car with upmarket potential, just like these lovely, wonderful, very posh people.
But I think quite soon Ford realised that they could and did begin to sell more upmarket versions of this motor car.
The years went on, more and more engine options were available, body styles developed, and trim options more than anything. And the options list itself was very, very long.
First there was a Super, then there was a GT. Then in a couple of years, the whole motor car was facelifted, both inside and out, and the whole process of what you might call gentrifying the Cortina started from there.
The Cortina wasn't just being snapped up by your average punter and your more than average crop of toffs. Sports fans were converting the car for a variety of motorsports.
I'm a classic car breaker, mainly. I buy in old cars and break them up for spare parts. We also do a bit of racing from here. Predominantly classic cars that have been stripped and all the parts sold. This is a Mark III Cortina. It came into me as a write-off. It had actually been damaged in an accident along the floor pan and along the driver's side. It's been totally stripped. Everything that can burn, everything that's not needed, all the wiring, the carpets, the glass, everything gets taken out before we start to prepare it for racing. This is a Mark V Cortina. As you can see, we cut the wings and the front to stop it getting crushed up behind the wheel. Under the bonnet, everything's missing apart from the engine. Basically, the radiator's gone, the battery, all the heater matrix, everything's out that we don't need, because we basically run this on as minimal as possible. One wire to the battery, to the coil, and one wire to the starter motor, and that is it. We bolt all the doors up with us very nice strong plates, nice bolts. It all helps protect the driver and it all helps keep the car running.
Ford found to their delight, not only was the Cortina very light, it was very strong. And before long, they said, this ought to be a good car for motorsport.
The Cortina Mark I was a superb rally car. This was because it was light and yet it was surprisingly rugged. It could take a real hammering.
And when the decision was taken, because the United States was beginning to move towards motorsport, again, lifestyles were expanding. Motorsport was obviously a good way of creating an image. It was decided then that we would have performance versions of the Cortina.
We come back to the famous name of Walter Hayes, who was their public affairs director for many years. Walter took one look at this car and said, this is a motor car Ford should use in motorsport, not only in rallying, but in motor racing as well. It was Walter Hayes who inspired the birth of the Lotus Cortina. That was the version of the Cortina which heroes like Jim Clark and Sir John Whitmore used in motor racing. It was a superb motor car. We must never forget, though, that cars like this Cortina also won the East African Safari, won the RAC Rally, and effectively made Ford a top name in motorsport.
Cortina in motorsport did Ford an enormous amount of good in terms of projecting to the car-buying public that we built really good cars. They were so good they could go out and win tough rallies.
But where are the classic winning Cortinas of those days? Well, behind the scenes of this garage in St Helens, we'll find two of these fantastic machines, lovingly looked after by Lotus Cortina expert Andy Middlehurst.
The earliest memory of Cortina was when I was about four at Ulton Park, looking at the back of one of these cars outside of my pram. After that, I had one when I was about 19 years of age and drove one for about 5 years on the road. This particular car is a 1963 Lotus Cortina. It's the 13th Lotus Cortina ever built. It's actually the second oldest surviving vehicle in the world. The oldest one is actually one used by Reynolds and Biggs in the Great Train Robbery. Well, this particular car really is my dream Cortina. I did a lot of research to find this particular car. It was the first works car built by Lotus, and it was raced by Jim Clark and Peter Arundel in 1963 and 1964. I actually tracked it down in America, and it had last raced in Florida in 1964. I've traced the owner and managed to buy it and got it shipped back to the UK. And it's just, the Lotus is, to me, is just a brilliant car. It's very quick, it's noisy, it's good handling, and it's got a lot of technology for its age.
And this is the 1964 Safari Rally in South Africa, where those Wurtz Cortinas showed the world how the car coped with over 3,000 miles of dust and rocks as they romped home to Nairobi to gain even more awards for Ford's mantelpiece.
While the track events were hitting the springtime headlines, a team of Wurtz-entered Cortina set out to conquer Africa in the 1964 Safari Rally. And what a conquest that was.
The car buying public saw Cortina winning a major European rally, or the Safari Rally in Kenya, which it did, and regularly. Then they thought, well, hang on, I can go and buy a car like that. Okay, one of the black bonnet, one of the super tuned engine, but it's a Ford Cortina, and it must be tough.
Peter Hughes, man of the hour in the car of the year, Cortina number 3, that showed the world how to tackle over 3,000 miles of Africa's terrible mud, dust and rocks and come romping home to Nairobi as the outright winner.
Cortina, although obviously not originally designed for the track, coped really well with sporty conversions and was sturdy enough to take the knocks, like this when Jack Sears ran out of road at Brands Hatch. Each new car had improvements. The Mark II, I've got to say, that's my favourite, had the airflow system and was the first car of its kind to have a ventilation system like this. Beforehand, so many cars had those little quarter-like windows, which helped robbers very much.
It's here, new Cortina. New Cortina is more Cortina. More looks, more go. More comfort. More Cortina for your money. Aeroflow ventilation.
The Cortina of 1964 was the first family car in the world to introduce what was called airflow ventilation. And what this meant was that the air came in there through the fresh air vents, the fresh air came into the cabin, and for the first time ever, there were exhaust vents in the rear pillars to pull what they called stale air out of it. Airflow meant through flow of air. Hadn't been thought of before. To do it previously, you had to wind down the windows.
The air was ducted from the heater unit through these side vents, which you can see could be rotated in any direction you wanted. And then the actual airflow was controlled through these vents here. That slow cold, fast cold, and then the warm air bleed. If you pulled it right out, you could actually bring warm air through here for demist in the winter.
The Cortina started a new motoring philosophy that put the ordinary family motorist right where the action was in a car that satisfied all his needs. The record speaks for itself, but the future presented a challenge to Ford to move into the 70s with a Cortina of the 70s, with a brand new car that raises the standards of family motoring to a new peak of excellence.
The Mark III Cortina arrived in late 1970. With its swept-back American styling, it was often referred to as the Coke bottle. And let's be honest, they nicked quite a few ideas there from the Vauxhall Victor.
And on the Prestige GXL, seating refinement reaches a new peak with a choice of movements in every direction. Forward and backwards, a fully reclining backrest, and easily operated, adjustable height. On all new Cortinas except the 1300, an alternator is standard equipment. To cut down noise, the wiper motor and the blower have both been moved forward into the engine compartment. And for winter motoring, there's a superbly simple twist to the air intake that will allow the engine to motor at an economic temperature.
After about 6 years of the highly successful Mark III, came the return of the familiar three square box arrangement that we saw on the Marks 1 and 2. Gone was the American look and feel, but many of the mechanicals stayed the same. Well, if it ain't broke.
First Cortina and the last. 20 years later, the motor car bears no relation whatsoever to the original. And for the great British icon, people tend to ignore the fact that it was designed by a German, Uwe Bunsen, but a classic in its time. And this is the actual last car to be driven from the line at Dagenham, which is now part of the Ford Heritage Collection. Great thing about this car, it still carries a lot of the hallmarks of the original Cortina, with aeroflow, but of course now wood capping on the door, wood cappings on the instrument panel, and a lot of features are standard. But actually what it brings to the customers who were buying this, all the comforts of home that they'd enjoyed in much larger and much more expensive motor cars.
Like almost every other motor car in the world, the Cortina started simple and got more complicated and got more glossy as the years went by. Not only did the motor car itself get ever so slightly bigger as the styling changes were made, it also became more expensive, and there were more and more versions. First of all, there were two doors and four doors, then there were estate cars, then there were GL versions, then there were gear versions, there were also engine tune-up jobs. It just was one of those motor cars where Ford's marketing team, which were and still are supreme, they listened, they looked, they thought, what does the public want? We will provide it for them.
Of course, every great car comes to the end of its life at some point. But nobody had really guessed the type of car that Ford would replace the best-selling Cortina with. Ford were busy working on a concept car known as the Probe. Nothing to do, by the way, with the production car of the same name. Surely this bizarre jelly mould wouldn't replace the much-loved Cortina. But yep, the Probe concept would become the Ford Sierra.
And the public went...
it had a more difficult launch in Britain than it did anywhere else in the world.
They went from a three-box saloon that everyone was happy with, and they tried to take the public forward and say, look, the car of the future is like this.
I think Ford probably wanted to do something a bit more different and go more of a more modern design, if you look at it from today's point of view. And I think the public didn't accept it because it wasn't what they wanted. It was totally different. It's like a jelly mould, basically, compared to what they used to own.
I've got to say, I suppose it was right, because these cars wouldn't be desirable now. You know, they had to change them. But I do think it was a big mistake. I think all new cars are a big mistake.
I guess it's just a case of fashions change, don't they? And they were trying to reinvent themselves to an ever-changing market.
Yeah, that was the end of an era. What's a Sierra? It's a disposable car today, you know, whereas the Cortina, it's got to be an up-and-coming classic.
Do you think we will be standing in a field in 20 years' time surrounded by Sierras or Mondeos? And most people seem to think no.
In the end, of course, the public finally caught up and realised that with a Sierra, you had the same luggage space, same passenger space as well as the Cortina, but you had the extra flexibility of a hatchback.
Now, there was a rumour that Ford were going to call their first world car that replaced the Sierra the Cortina. But of course, that became the Mondeo. But I do hope that at some time in the future, we will get that name back again. And we will be able to sing, you and I together, lustily, Gina, I've got a Cortina. Listen, you take it easy. Thanks for watching. See ya. God bless. Bye-bye.